A warm welcome to all of you. I present this lecture mainly for 3rd BSc chemistry students of our college during the critical situation of COVID-19 pandemic. This topic, that is dilute solution and colligative properties, this topic is present in physical chemistry 1 syllabus of our Bharathidasan University. And this 4.3 and 4.4, the syllabus, that is dilute solution and the colligative properties. This lecture is more useful for UG students during this period in the absence of regular classes. As this lecture is planned for UG students of our college, first I want to read the syllabus. Syllabus in Physical Chemistry 1, 4th unit 4.3 and 4.4. 4.3 dilute solutions, colligative properties, relative lowering of vapor pressure, osmosis, law of osmotic pressure, derivation of elevation of boiling point and depression and freezing point, and next 4.4, determination of molecular masses using colligative properties, abnormal molecular masses, molecular dissociation, degree of dissociation, molecular association. Now dilute solution. Now what is dilute solution? Solution means homogeneous mixture of minimum of two components. That is homogeneous mixture of minimum of two components, that is called solution. And component which is in larger amount is known as solvent. Component which is in lesser amount is known as solute. Your solution means that is which contains two species. One is solvent, another one is solute. And the mixture of these two must be homogeneous. Then only the mixture is called as solution. So solution means homogeneous mixture of minimum of two components. The component which is in larger amount, that is called solvent. The component which is in lesser amount is known as solute. And dilute solution means the solution with a very low amount of solute in compared with the solvent, or in other words, solution with a large amount of solvent in compared with the amount of solute. So as a dilute solution, it may contains large amount of solvent. In other words, it contains small amount of solute. So dilute solution, that is a solution with a low amount of solute and with larger amount of solvent, that is called dilute solutions. Next, types of solution. There are depending upon the physical state of the solution, there are three types: gaseous solution, which is in the form of gaseous state, and liquid solution, which is in the form of liquid state, and the solid solution, which is in the state of solid state. In gaseous solutions, there are three types. That is depending upon the nature of solute and solvent. There are three types. That is three types of solute, three types of solvent. And with the three types of solvent and three types of solute, there are number of examples. One example is gas in gas. That is, both are gaseous state. For example, here mixture of gases. That is one type of gaseous solution. Another one is liquid in gas. Liquid in gas means humid oxygen. So liquid is water, that is liquid in gas. Solute is liquid, solvent is gas. Another one type, solid and gas, camphor in nitrogen gas. That is camphor is solid and that is solute, solvent is nitrogen gas. So these are three types. Similarly, in the case of liquid solutions, there are three types. And in the case of solid solution also, there are three types depending upon the physical state of solute and solvent, and each one has a number of examples. So this table shows types of solution on physical state, that is gas in gas, liquid in gas, solid in gas. That is one gaseous solution and a liquid solution. Gas in liquid, liquid in liquid, solid in liquid, that is a liquid solution. And solid solution, gas in solid, liquid in solid, solid in solid. These are solid solutions. So depending upon the nature of solute and solvents, there are nine types of solutions depending upon nature of physical state of solute and solvent. Next, another type of classification, that is types of solution on characteristics. So there are two types. One is ideal solution, another one is non-ideal solution. So what is meant by ideal solution? Ideal solution means that solution has certain characteristics. Now what are the characteristics? One characteristic, that is during mixing, there is no change in the volume of the two components. there is no change in the volume on mixing the two components. Two component means solute and solvent. So that is delta V mixing is equal to zero. Delta V mixing is equal to zero. That is during mixing of the components, the change in volume is equal to zero. That is delta V mixing is equal to zero. That is one characteristic. Another characteristic, that is during mixing, there is no change, no exchange of heat when the solute is dissolved in solvent. That is during mixing of the two components, no changes, no change of heat. That is heat is not evolved or heat is not absorbed. There is no change. Delta V mixing is equal to zero. That is another characteristic. And the third characteristic, the force of attraction between molecules of solute and molecules of the solvent are same. That is, suppose if you take two components A and B, then there is a forces between A and A molecule and B and B molecules and A and B molecules are same. All the forces are same. Suppose any system with these characteristics, that then we say the solution is ideal solution. Example for ideal solution is benzene and toluene. Benzene mixture of benzene and toluene, that is an example for ideal solution. So depending upon the characteristics, we can classify the solution to two. One is ideal solution, another one is non-ideal solution. Ideal solution has three characteristics, that is delta V mixing is equal to zero, delta H mixing is equal to zero, and force of attraction between molecules of solute and molecules of solvent, and forces between molecules of solute of another molecules of the same solute and solvent, and also the forces between the solvent molecules are, say, all are same. So this carry, if a solution which satisfy, if a solution which satisfies these conditions, then we say that solution is ideal solutions. A non-ideal solution. Non-ideal solution means the solution which do not obey Raoult's law are called non-ideal solution. For a non-ideal solution, there is a change in the volume and enthalpy upon mixing. That is, delta H mixing is not equal to zero. Delta V mixing is not equal to zero. And force of attraction between molecules of solute and molecules of solvent are not same. That is, forces between A and A, B and B, and A and B are different. These characteristics, if a solution has this type of characteristics, then we say that solution is non-ideal solution. For example, mixture of ethyl alcohol and water. In this case, delta H mixing is not equal to zero, delta V mixing is not equal to zero, and also the force of attraction are not same. So there any solution which has this type of characteristics, then we say that solution is non-ideal solution. Next one, concentration units. Concentration units. There are number of concentration units. One is molality. Molality. Question may be asked, define molality. So what is molality? That is number of moles of solute present in 1000 grams of solvent. That is very important. 1000 grams of solvent. That is called molality. So the formula M small m is equal to W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. Here W2 weight of solute, M2 molecular weight of solute, and W1 weight of solvent, weight of solvent. Here in general, 1 is given for solvent, 2 is given for solute. W1 means, that is weight of solvent. W2 means weight of solute. M2 means molecular weight of solute. So molality, suppose for a compound, if the substance weight is given and the weight of the solvent is given, then we can easily calculate molality using the formula, that is M is equal to W2 weight of solute into 1000 divided by molecular weight of solute into weight of solvent. So by simply substituting weight of solute and molecular weight of solute and weight of solvent, we can simply calculate molality, that is the number of moles of solute present in 1000 grams of solvent. 1000 grams of solvent, that is molality. Then another concentration term is molarity. R, molarity, capital M. This is number of moles of solute present in 1000 ml of the solution. Here two difference. One is ml, another one is solution. There is number of moles of solute present in 1000 ml of the solution. Here also the formula, capital M is equal to W2 into 1 divided by M2 into W, not W, V. V, that is volume in liter, volume of the solution in liter. So W2 weight of solute, M2 molecular weight of solute, and V in liter, that is very important. Volume of the solution, V is the volume of the solution in liter. Using the formula, we can simply calculate molarity of the solution, molarity of the solution. Next, another concentration term, normality. Normality means number of gram equivalent weight of your solute in 1 liter of solution, 1 liter of solution. That is normality formula, that is weight per liter divided by equivalent weight. That is normality. That is number of gram equivalent weight of a solute in in 1 liter, in 1 liter of solution, that is called normality. So we have seen 3 concentration units: molality, molarity, and normality. So these are the 3 concentration units. Next, another topic, that is colligative property. Now, what is colligative property? Property which depends on only number of solute particles. Merely number of solute particles, the property which depends only on number of solute particles, that is called colligative properties. So there are 4 properties. One property, lowering of vapor pressure, that is given by delta P. Another one is elevation of boiling point, that symbol delta TB, and depression freezing point, that is delta TF. And another 4th one is osmotic pressure, and the symbol for osmotic pressure, that is pi. So these are the 4 colligative properties. And the first property, lowering of vapor pressure, delta P. So vapor pressure of pure solvent is lowered by the addition of solute particles, and the lowering depends on number of solute particles. That is why lowering of vapor pressure is a colligative property. That is, vapor pressure of pure solvent is lowered by the addition of solute particles, and the lowering depends on number of solute particles, and that is delta P is equal to P10 minus P1, where P10 vapor pressure of pure solvent, that is zero solute, and P1, that is the vapor pressure of solvent in solution, that is that solution contains solute particle. That is why the P1 symbol, P10 means vapor pressure of pure solvent, 0 indicates zero solute, and P1, that is vapor pressure of solvent in solution, the solution contains solute and solvent. Next one is Raoult's law, and this law states that in the case of a solution of volatile liquids, the partial pressure of each component A and component B of the solution is directly proportional to its mole fraction. Symbol of mole fraction is x. And if we take the solvent, vapor pressure of solvent in solution is given by, that is, P1 is directly proportional to x1, that is equal to x1 P10. That is, vapor pressure of solvent in solution is given by, that is, P1 is equal to x1 P10, and x1, that is a mole fraction of solvent, and P10, that is the vapor pressure of pure solvent. So here P10, that is vapor pressure of pure solvent, and P1, that is the vapor pressure of solvent in solution. So that is P1 is equal to x1 P10. That can be written as P10 that is equal to x1. But for any solution, mole fraction of the component, the sum of mole fraction of components, that is equal to 1. So if in a system contains 2, that is component 1 and component 2, and x1 is solvent, 2 is solute, and x1 plus x2, that is equal to 1. So x1 is equal to 1 minus x2. x1 is the mole fraction of solvent in the solution, x2 is the mole fraction of solute in the solution. So x1 is equal to 1 minus x2. So p1 divided by p10, that is equal to 1 minus x2. On changing minus x2 from right hand side to left hand side, and p1 by p10 from left hand side to right hand side, now x2 is equal to 1 minus p1 by p10. On taking LCM p10, and now x2 is equal to p10 minus p1 divided by p10. So in the numerator, that is a lowering of vapor pressure, and in the denominator, vapor pressure of pure solvent. So lowering of vapor pressure, that is given by delta P, and delta P divided by P10, that is called relative lowering of vapor pressure. that is equal to mole fraction of solute. Mole fraction of solute. So the Raoult's law is otherwise stated as relative lowering of vapor pressure of an ideal solution containing non-volatile solute is equal to the mole fraction of solute at a given temperature. That is, relative lowering of vapor pressure of an ideal solution containing non-volatile solute is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. So that is, otherwise, mole fraction of solute in solution is given by relative lowering of vapor pressure. That is, relative lowering of vapor pressure is equal to mole fraction of solute in the solution. That is Raoult's law. This question may be asked frequently in the university examination. I explain Raoult's law or state Raoult's law, etc. The next topic is determination of molar mass of solute from the colligative property relative lowering of vapor pressure. So one of the use of all the colligative properties, one of the use is that property, these properties are used to determine molecular weight of unknown solute, molecular weight of a solute. So in the sense, the lowering of vapor pressure, that property is also used to determine molecular weight of unknown solute. How the molecular weight of unknown solute is determined from relative lowering of vapor pressure? For that, P10 and P1. P10, that is the vapor pressure of pure solvent, and P1, vapor pressure of solvent in solution. These two data are determined experimentally. And from the use of Raoult's law, we can determine the molecular weight of unknown solute, that is M2. The symbol is M2. So that is P10, P1 divided by P10, that is equal to X2, that is Raoult's law. Now X2 is equal to N2 divided by N1 plus N2. N2 is the number of moles of solute and N1 number of moles of solvent. But the case of dilute solution, in compared with N1, N2 is negligible. So in the denominator, we can write instead of N1 plus N2, we can write N1 neglecting the term N2. So numerator is N2, denominator is N1, that is N2 by N1. And we know N2 number of moles, that is the formula, weight divided by molecular weight. So N2 is equal to W2 divided by M2, and N1 is equal to W1 divided by M1. W1 means weight of solvent, M1 means molecular weight of solvent. So by simply substituting these values for N2 and N1, we get W2 divided by M2 divided by W1 divided by M1. That is W2 into M1 divided by W1 into M2. So by knowing P10 and P1 and W1 and W2 and M1, M2 can be calculated. Knowing all other terms except M2, that can be calculated. That is the molecular weight of unknown solute. Here the experiment data is vapor pressure of pure solvent and vapor pressure of solvent in solution. These are experimentally determined, and by substituting all others except M2, that can be calculated. Another colligative property is elevation of boiling point. The symbol is delta TB. So boiling point of pure solvent is elevated by the addition of solute particles, and the elevation depends on number of solute particles. So that is delta TB is proportional to molality of the solution, that is equal to a proportionality constant, that is KB. So delta TB is equal to KB into molality. Now we have the formula for molality. So delta TB is equal to KB W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. So here delta TB, elevation boiling point, and KB, molar elevation constant, otherwise called as ebullioscopic constant, another name, ebullioscopic constant. And we know W1 weight of pure solvent, W2 weight of solute, M2 molecular weight of solute, and delta TB, that is elevation in boiling point. Now we can define define KB, molar elevation constant. If molality is equal to 1, then delta TB is equal to KB. Sometimes question may be asked, define molar elevation constant. So molar elevation constant is nothing but elevation boiling point given by one molar solution. One molar solution. That is molality. If molality is equal to 1, delta TB is equal to KB. That is KB is the elevation boiling point given by one molar solution. That is a solution with molality 1. So that is the definition of KB. That definition of KB, that is elevation of boiling point given by one molar solution. Each component has its own KB value. Each component has its own KB value. These are about elevation of boiling point. The next topic is determination of molecular weight of solute from this colligative property, elevation in boiling point. Now, if a solution is prepared dissolving W2 gram solute in W1 gram of solvent, then the formula for molality, that is molality, is equal to W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. And W1, we know all these values. W1 is equal to weight of pure solvent, W2 weight of solute, M2 molecular weight of solute. And by substituting molality in the equation, delta TB equation, now delta TB is equal to KB into W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. That is the equation for elevation boiling point. Now KB, that is molar elevation constant or ebullioscopic constant, and delta TB elevation boiling point, that is boiling point of pure solvent and boiling point of solutions. These two are determined experimentally, and T1, that is a boiling point of pure solvent, and T2 boiling point of solution, and so T2 minus T1, that is given, that is delta TB, that is elevation in boiling point. So delta TB is experimentally determined, and by substituting all the values except M2, that can be calculated. Suppose the KB of solvent is not known, then by using a solute with a known molecular weight, and the delta TB is experimentally determined, and by substituting the known molecular weight and W2, W1, and knowing all other terms except KB, that can be calculated. If KB is unknown, known solute is used. Otherwise, if KB is known, using that KB of solvent is known, using that solvent, and by experiment determination of delta TB and known values of W1, W2, M2 can be calculated. That is the determination of molecular weight of solute from the colligative property, elevation in boiling point. The next topic is thermodynamic derivation of elevation in boiling point. That is the delta TB equation, that is thermodynamically derived. That is thermodynamic derivation. By using an equation from thermodynamics, this equation is derived. That is called thermodynamic derivation of elevation in boiling point. So for that, integrated form of Clausius, Kleypeyrand equation, that is from thermodynamics, that equation is taken. What is that equation? Ln P2 by P1 is equal to delta HV by R T2 minus T1 divided by T1 T2. This equation is integrated form of Clausius, Kleypeyrand equation, that is a standard equation, a well-known famous equation, Clausius, Kleypeyrand equation. Now here P1, P2, T1, T2, delta HV, or these are the terms. Now P1 and P2 are the two vapor pressures at two temperatures, T1 and T2. P1, P2 are the vapor pressure at two temperatures, T1 and T2. And delta HV, molar latent heat of vaporization, and R is the gas constant. So using this equation, we can derive the equation for delta TB. That derivation is called as thermodynamic derivation. Now a liquid boils when the vapor pressure of the liquid attains atmospheric pressure. Any liquid boils if its vapor pressure is equal to atmospheric pressure. So now we can plot vapor pressure versus temperature for solvent and solutions. So that graph is shown in the slide. That is, vapor pressure is plotted against temperature, and one curve is for solvent, another curve for solution, and T1 at temperature T1, vapor pressure of solvent is equal to atmospheric pressure. So T1 is the boiling point of solvent, and T2 at temperature T2, vapor pressure of solution is equal to atmospheric pressure. So T2 is the boiling point of solution. T1, it is a boiling point of solvent, At that temperature, vapor pressure of solvent is equal to atmospheric pressure. And T2, that is a boiling point of solution at that temperature, vapor pressure of solution is equal to atmospheric pressure. So T1 and T2 are the boiling points of solvent and solution. So now consider the graph AB graph. Now A one point, B is another point, and at point A the temperature is, corresponding temperature is T1, and corresponding vapor pressure, that is the vapor pressure of solution, that is P1. But at point B the temperature is T2, that is a boiling point of solution, but the vapor pressure of pure solvent, that is corresponding to, both are same, so B, the dotted lines are given. So P10, that is the vapor pressure of pure solvent, and temperature is D2, that is a boiling point of solution. But at point A, the temperature is T1, that is a boiling point of solvent, but the vapor pressure is, that is the vapor pressure of solvent in solution. Solvent in solution, simply solution. So by substituting the two temperatures, T1 and T2, corresponding vapor pressures P1 and P10 in the Claisius-Claiborne equation. Now we get an equation, that is ln P10 divided by P1, that is equal to delta HV divided by R, and then T2 minus T1 divided by T1 T2. So at two temperatures, T1 T2 and two pressures are corresponding pressures are substituted in the Claisius-Claiborne equation. Now we get this equation, ln P10, that is at point B, and point A P1, so P10 divided by P1, that is equal to delta HV divided by R, T2 at point B and T1 at point A. So T2 minus T1 divided by T1 T2. So T2 minus T1, that is called elevation boiling points, that is delta TB. So this equation can be written as, by changing logarithmic to negative logarithm, so minus ln P1 divided by P10 by inverting the terms in the square bracket. So there is a minus sign, so here inverted, the terms in the square bracket is inverted. So minus ln P1 divided by P10, that is equal to delta HV divided by R, delta TB divided by T1 T2. Let this equation be 2, and from this equation we can derive the equation for delta TB by using Raoult's law. That can be seen in the next slide. According to Raoult's law, P1 by P10, that is equal to x1, and x1 plus x2, that is equal to 1. That is, for any system, sum of mole fraction of components is equal to 1. So for a system containing two components 1 and 2, x1 plus x2 is equal to 1. That is, x1 is equal to 1 minus x2. So the equation P1 by P10, that is equal to 1 minus x2. Now on taking negative logarithm of left hand side and right hand side, we get minus ln P1 by P10, that is equal to minus ln 1 minus x2. For dilute solution, x2 is small. So the equation, in the case of equation minus ln 1 minus x2, mathematically, if x2 is equal to small, then left hand side is equal to simply x2. So on substituting this in the above equation, minus ln P1 by P10 is equal to x2, that is equal to x2. So equation 2 becomes x2 is equal to delta HV by R, delta TB divided by T1 T2. Now the T1 is the boiling point of solvent, T2 boiling point of solution, and the difference between these two is small. So we can replace T2 by T1, T2 is replaced by T1. So the equation becomes x2 is equal to delta HV delta TB divided by RT 1 square. From this equation, we can get the equation for delta TB by rearranging, that is by shifting the other terms in the, on the other another side, and delta TB is equal to RT 1 square divided by delta HV into X2. Let this equation be 3. And X2 here is the mole fraction of solute, that is X2 is equal to N2 divided by N1 plus N2. So here N1 is the number of moles of solvent, N2 is the number of moles of solute. In the case of dilute solution, N2 is negligible in compared with N1. So the denominator, that is X2 is equal to N2 divided by N1 plus N2, in this equation denominator N1 plus N2, it becomes N1, it becomes N1, that is X2 is equal to N2 divided by N1. So in terms of weight and molecular weight, that is number of moles is equal to weight divided by molecular weight. So N2 is equal to W2 divided by M2 and N1 is equal to W1 divided by M1. So on substituting these values in the equation X2, we get W2 divided by M2 divided by W1 into M1, W1 divided by M1, that is equal to W2 into M1 divided by W1 into M2. So the equation 3 becomes delta TB is equal to RT1 square divided by delta HV X2, that is equal to RT1 square divided by delta HV W2 into M1 divided by W1 into M2. So now changing M1 from numerator to denominator along with the delta HV, now the equation becomes RT1 square W2 divided by delta HV divided by M1 and the another denominator terms, that is W1 into M2. So delta HV, that is molar latent heat of appreciation, but delta HV divided by M1, that is small LV, that is latent heat of appreciation per gram. Therefore the equation, double equation becomes, that is delta TB is equal to RT1 square divided by LV and the numerator W2 divided by W1 into M2, W1 divided W1 into M2. So let this equation be 4. Now if molality of the solution is equal to 1, now what is 1 molar solution, that is number of moles of solute is 1 and weight of solvent is 1000 gram, then we say that solution has a molality 1, that solution is 1 molar solution. So if molality is equal to 1, then substitute the value W2 divided by M2 is equal to 1 and W1 is equal to 1000 gram. So on substituting these two in the fourth equation, so equation 4 becomes delta TB is equal to RT1 square divided by 1000 into LV, 1000 into LV. Now let this equation be 5, and this is the equation that gives elevation boiling point by 1 molar solution, 1 molar solution. So by the definition of KB, this is equal to delta TB. What is KB? That is elevation boiling point given by 1 molar solution. So this is elevation boiling point given by 1 molar solution. So this equation 5 is KB, simply KB. So we can substitute the KB value in fourth equation, we get the final equation, and that is in the next slide. So KB, I already told KB is molar boiling point elevation constant or ebullioscopic constant, and KB is equal to the elevation boiling point for 1 molar solution. So by the definition of KB, equation by 5 becomes delta TB is equal to RT1 square divided by LV into 1000, that is equal to KB. Let this equation be 6. Now on substituting equation 6 in 4, and delta TB is equal to KB W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. Here delta TB elevation in boiling point, KB molar elevation constant or ebullioscopic constant, W1 weight of pure solvent, W2 weight of solute, and M2 molecular weight of solute. Now this equation is the equation for elevation boiling point, and thus the equation is thermodynamically derived by taking an equation from thermodynamics. That equation is Clausius Clapeyron equation, that is famous equation. So these are about thermodynamic derivation of elevation and boiling point. Next one is depression freezing point. Freezing point of pure solvent is depressed by the addition of solute particles, and the depression depends on number of solute particles. So the property depression freezing point is a colligative property. So now delta T of, that is the symbol for depression freezing point, that is proportional to molality. That is delta T of is equal to Kf into molality. Here Kf is the proportionality constant, and Kf, that is molar depression constant or cryoscopic constant. Now the equation, delta equation for delta T of is, delta T of is equal to Kf into W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. That is Kf into molality. Kf into molality. Now here Kf, that is molar depression constant or cryoscopic constant, delta T of depression freezing point, W1 weight of pure solvent, and W2 weight of solute, and M2 molecular weight of solute, and delta T of is equal to Kf into molality. If molality is equal to 1, then delta T of is equal to Kf. So the definition of Kf, that is depression freezing point given by 1 molar solution. So that is depression freezing point if the concentration of the solution is 1 molality, 1 molality. Now each component has its own Kf value. Okay. Next one is thermodynamic derivation of depression and freezing point. That is the equation for delta Tf. So for that, Clausius-Clapeyron equation is taken, and integrated form of Clausius-Clapeyron equation is ln P2 divided by P1 is equal to delta Hf if the process is fusion process. Now delta Hf divided by R T2 minus T1 divided by T1 T2. Here P1 and P2 are the pressures, vapor pressures at temperatures at T1 and T2, and delta Hf or LF, capital LF, that is molar latent heat of fusion, and P1 and P2, these are the vapor pressures at corresponding temperatures, and R gas constant. Now let P1 zero vapor pressure of pure solvent, and P1 vapor pressure of solvent solution, and the corresponding temperatures is T1 and T2. And here T1 is the freezing point of solvent, and T2 freezing point of solution. Now delta Tf, that is given by depression freezing point, that is T1 minus T2. Depression freezing point, that is a freezing point of solvent minus freezing point of solution, that is delta Tf. So on applying these pressures P1 0 and corresponding temperatures in the starting equation, Clausius-Clapeyron equation, now the equation becomes ln P10 divided by P1, that is equal to delta Hf divided by R, and in the numerator delta Tf divided by T1 T2. So that is ln P1 by P10 that is equal to delta Hf delta Tf divided by R T1 T2. But according to Raoult's law, that is P1 by P10, that is equal to X1. But X1 is equal to 1 minus X2. Therefore, P1 by P10, that is equal to 1 minus X2. So the negative logarithm of P1 by P10, that is equal to negative logarithm of 1 minus X2. So for dilute solution X2, the value of X2 is small. So mathematically -ln(1 - X2) is equal to X2, where X2 is, when X2 is small. When X2 is equal to small, this equation left hand side becomes X2 mathematically. So the above equations, that is equation number 2 becomes X2, left hand side is X2, that is equal to delta Hf delta Tf divided by R T1 T2. Now here T1 and T2, T1 is the freezing point of pure solvent, and T2 freezing point of solution, but the difference is small. The T2 is replaced by T1. So the equation is X2 is equal to delta Hf into delta Tf divided by R T1 square. From this equation we can get the equation for delta Tf by rearranging the remaining terms on the another side. So delta Tf is equal to RT1 square divided by delta Hf, and in the numerator X2. let this equation be 3. Here delta Tf, that is depression freezing point, and T1 is the freezing point of pure solvent, and delta Hf molar depression constant of the not molar depression constant, that is latent heat of molar latent heat of fusion, molar latent heat of fusion. Delta Hf is molar latent heat of fusion, that is amount of heat required to transform one mole of solvent to its vapor, that is delta Hf. So delta Tf is equal to RT1 square x2 divided by delta Hf. But here x2, that is a mole fraction of solute, that is equal to n2 divided by n1 plus n2. And here also in the case of dilute solution, n2 is negligible in compared with n1. So the denominator becomes n1 plus n2 becomes n1. Therefore x2 is equal to n2 divided by n1. In terms of weight and molecular weight, that is n2 is equal to W2 divided by m2, and n1 is equal to W1 divided by m1. Therefore x2 is equal to W2 divided by m2 divided by W1 divided by m1, that is equal to W2 into m1 divided by W1 into m2. So on substituting this equation in the equation number 3, we get the final equation. Now the equation 3 becomes delta Tf is equal to RT1 square W2 into M1 divided by delta Hf into W1 into M2. So on changing the M1 from numerator to denominator along with the delta Hf, this equation becomes RT1 square W2 divided by delta Hf divided by M1, and in the denominator W1 into M2. Here delta Hf divided by M1, that is simply small LF, that is latent heat of fusion per gram. Delta Hf, that is molar latent heat of fusion. So molar latent heat of fusion divided by molecular weight of the solvent, and that is given by latent heat of fusion of solvent per gram. So the equation becomes delta Tf is equal to RT1 square W2 divided by LF, small LF, into W1 into M2. So let this equation be 4. If molality of the solution is equal to 1, now the molality is equal to 1 means that is W2 divided by M2 is equal to 1, and W1 is equal to 1000 gram. So the equation becomes, equation 4 becomes delta Tf is equal to RT1 square divided by LF into 1000, LF into 1000. So let this equation be 5. Now Kf, molar freezing point, depression constant or cryoscopic constant, and Kf is equal to the depression freezing point for one molar solution. That is the definition. By the definition of Kf, delta Tf for one molar solution, that is exactly equal to Kf. So the equation 5 becomes delta Tf, that is given by, that is depression freezing point given by one molar solution. So by the definition of Kf, this delta Tf is equal to Kf. So let this equation be 6. On substituting 6 in equation number 4, for any molar solution, and delta Tf is equal to Kf into W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. So instead of RT1 square divided by LF, we substitute Kf into 1000. So the equation 4 becomes delta Tf is equal to Kf into 1000 into W2 divided by M2 into W1, that is equal to Kf into W2 into 1000 divided by M2 into W1. Here delta Tf is the depression freezing point, and Kf molar depression constant or cryoscopic constant, and W1 weight of pure solvent, W2 weight of solute, M2 is the molecular weight of solute. So this is the equation for delta Tf, depression freezing point. Thus this equation is derived from a starting equation, integrated form of Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So this derivation is thermodynamic derivation of depression in freezing point. Next, osmotic pressure. Next colligative property is osmotic pressure. Now what is osmosis? That is the spontaneous flow of solvent particle from solvent side to solution side when they are separated by semi-permeable membrane. That is known as osmosis. So that is spontaneous flow of solvent particles from solvent side to solution side when they are separated by semi-permeable membrane. So due to this process, a pressure is developed on solvent side, that is called osmotic pressure. So otherwise, the osmotic pressure, otherwise it can be defined as the pressure that must be applied to solution side to stop osmosis. That is a pressure applied to solution side to stop osmosis. That pressure is called as osmotic pressure. Here the osmotic pressure is also depends upon number of solute particles. That is why osmotic pressure is a colligative property. So next, Van der Waals equation, Van der Waals laws for osmosis. So first we state the laws, and from that we can there is simple equation. That equation is called as Van der Waals equation. So Van der Waals equation is nothing but pi is equal to CRT, pi osmotic pressure, C concentration of the solution, R gas constant, and T temperature. First, Van der Waals laws for osmosis. What is the Van der Waals laws? So there are three statements, and three statements are called as Van der Waals laws. So one statement: at constant concentration, the osmotic pressure is directly proportional to temperature of the solution. That is, pi is directly proportional to T. Pi is proportional to T. That is first statement. Another statement: at constant temperature, the osmotic pressure is directly proportional to concentration of the solution. Concentration of the solution, that is pi is proportional to C. And third point: in general, osmotic pressure is directly proportional to molar concentration of the solution and the temperature of the solution. That is, pi is directly proportional to CT, that is equal to CRT, that is equal to RCT, that is simply written as CRT, where C is the concentration of the solution in molarity, and T temperature, and R gas constant. This is Van der Waals laws for osmosis and Van der Waals equation for osmosis. There are three statements, and combining three, and from these three statements we can derive an equation. That equation is called as Van der Waals equation for osmosis. That is, pi is equal to CRT. But next one is determination of molecular weight of solute from the colligative property osmotic pressure. I have already told all these colligative properties are used to determine molecular weight of unknown solute. And that sense, osmotic pressure is also used to determine molecular weight of unknown solute. Now, according to Van der Waals equation, pi is equal to CRT. Here, C is the concentration. Concentration, that is number of moles per liter, that is N divided by total volume in liters. N is the number of moles of solute, and B is the volume of the solution in liter. So, on simply substituting, C is equal to N by V, pi is equal to NRT by V. N is the number of moles of solute, R gas constant, T temperature, and V is the volume of the solution. By substituting all these values, one can simply calculate the value of osmotic pressure pi. And if pi is calculated using above equation, that pi osmotic pressure is theoretical osmotic pressure. And if the solution is prepared by dissolving W2 gram of non-volatile solute in V liter of solvent, then number of moles N is given by N is equal to W2 divided by M2. W2 divided by M2, that is weight divided by molecular weight. Weight of solute divided by molecular weight of solute, that is number of moles of solute. So on substituting the N value in the equation number 1, we get pi V is equal to W2 RT by M2. So that is, pi is equal to W2 RT divided by V into M2. And W2 weight of solute in solution of volume V liters, R gas constant, T temperature, and M2 is the molecular weight of solute. By experimental determination, of osmotic pressure pi, and knowing all other terms except M2, that can be calculated, that is the molecular weight of unknown solute. Thus, if osmotic pressure is the experimental osmotic pressure, then the molecular weight is, it is the molecular weight of a solute in the molecular weight of solute in the solution, molecular weight of solute, that is. Now we can write one of equation in different ways. So one, pi is equal to CRT. Another one is, if by substituting C is equal to N by V, another equation, pi is equal to NRT by V. And by substituting N is equal to W2 divided by M2, pi is equal to W2 RT divided by V into M2. And by putting W2 divided by V as weight per liter, the equation becomes weight per liter into RT divided by M2. So these are the different forms of Hondrath equation. So on depending upon the data available, we can use any one of the equation to calculate osmotic pressure. So another topic, isotonic solution. Now what is isotonic solutions? That is different solutions with the same osmotic pressure. The solutions are osmotic solutions. So that is, if A, B, C, these are the three solutions, and all these solutions have the same osmotic pressure, then we say these are isotonic solutions. That is, if A, B, C are isotonic, means all are having same osmotic pressure.
For abnormal molar mass, that is abnormal molecular weight, the molar mass of non-volatile solute can be calculated accurately using the experimental determination of colligative properties. That is, from experimental determination of colligative properties, we can simply calculate molar mass, that is molecular weight of the compound. But in this method, we assume that the solution is very dilute, and also there is no dissociation or association of solute particles in the solution. If there is no dissociation or association, then only the experimental molecular weight is exactly equal to theoretical molecular weight. But in concentrated solution, the interaction between the solute and solvent becomes significant and reflected in the measured colligative properties. That is, in concentrated solution, there is a possibility of dissociation of solute particles or association of solute particles. That changes the molecular weight, which is determined from colligative properties. So that experimental colligative property, that is experimental molecular weight, experimental molecular weight is different from theoretical molecular weight. That is, due to dissociation or association, the molecular weight determined from colligative property, that is different from the theoretical molecular weight. This type of molecular weight, that is called abnormal molecular weight. Now, association of solute particles. But due to association of solute particles in the solution, the number of particles is decreased. That is why the colligative property is also decreased. And the molecular weight determined from experimental colligative property, that is greater than theoretical molecular weight. For example, in the case of acetic acid, the molar mass, the molecular weight of acetic acid calculated using experimental colligative property is found to be 120 gram per mole. That is two times the actual molar mass, that is 60 gram per mole. So that is, the acetic acid dimerizes in the solution, and due to association, and the number of particles is decreased. And the colligative property, that is also decreased due to decrease in number of particles. And the molecular weight, experimental molecular weight from experimental colligative property, that is greater than theoretical molecular weight. These are about association of solute particles in the solution. Next one is in dissociation of solute particles. So the electrolytes such as KCl, NaCl, etc., these electrolytes dissociate completely into its constituent ions, and number of particles increases due to dissociation. Now this increase in the number of particles increases the colligative property, and from the experimental colligative property, the molecular weight determined is less than theoretical molecular weight. So this type of process, that is called dissociation of solute particles. If we take NaCl as an example, it gives two ions, Na plus and Cl minus. So the in solution it gives two particles. So the colligative property, experimental colligative property is greater and molecular weight determined from the experimental colligative property is less than theoretical molecular weight. Next one is Van der factor. So due to dissociation or association of solute particles in a solution will result in the increase. Due to dissociation, there is increase of particles, and due to association, there is a decrease in number of particles. That is why the colligative property is also changed, and this variation of colligative property due to association or dissociation, we have Van der used a term that is called Van der factor. That is, Van der factor is nothing but that is observed colligative property divided by theoretical calculated colligative property. Calculated colligative property means that is the property which is calculated using the formula. But observed colligative property means that is a colligative property which is experimentally determined. Now this Van der factor that is given, that is theoretical molecular weight divided by observed molecular weight. Here also theoretical molecular weight means that is a molecular weight calculated using the formula, just formula. But experimental colligative property means that is experimental molecular weight means, and that is a molecular weight calculated from experimental colligative property. So I is equal to theoretical molecular weight divided by observed molecular weight. That is equal to observed colligative property divided by theoretical colligative property. That is a molecular weight and colligative property. These two are inversely proportional. So I is equal to theoretical molecular weight divided by observed molecular weight. That is equal to observed colligative property divided by theoretical colligative property. So for dissociation process, I is greater than 1. Because observed molecular weight is less than theoretical molecular weight. But in the case of association, I is less than 1 due to observed molecular weight is greater than theoretical molecular weight. Now this slide shows the various characteristics on association and dissociation of solute particles. Now these are already discussed in the previous slides, but in these slides the characteristics are tabulated in a form, in a table. And process, suppose the process association of solute particle, then the number of particles decreases, colligative property increases, and observed molecular weight is greater than theoretical molecular weight, and Van der factor I is less than 1. And if the process is dissociation, then number of particles increases and colligative properties, that property decreases, and observed molecular weight is less than theoretical molecular weight, and I is greater than 1. And if there is no dissociation or association, there is no change in number of particles, and observed colligative property is equal to theoretical colligative property, and observed molecular weight is equal to theoretical molecular weight, and I is equal to 1. If the I value is 1, then there is no dissociation or association. If I is greater than 1, then the process in the solution is dissociation. If I is less than 1, then the process is association of solute particles in the solutions. Next topic is degree of dissociation. So the symbol for degree of dissociation is alpha. And what is degree of dissociation? That is fraction of 1 mole which is dissociated into ions. That is fraction of 1 mole which is dissociated into ions. And the symbol for degree of dissociation is alpha. So now consider a reaction. A gives A reversible arrow P plus Q plus R plus etc. The number of ions produced is N ions. That is, from one molecule, N ions are produced. So that process, that is called dissociation. Now let 1 mole of A is present initially, and alpha be the fraction of this 1 mole which is dissociated. So at equilibrium, after attaining equilibrium, 1 minus alpha is the number of moles of A, and N alpha, that is, there are N ions are produced. So N alpha is the number of moles of products. So in the case of Van der factor, there is a formula that is van der Waals factor is equal to total number of moles at equilibrium divided by initial number of moles. So total number of moles at equilibrium, that is given by 1 minus alpha, that is number of moles of A, reactant A at equilibrium, plus n alpha, that is the number of moles of the product formed due to dissociation. So the numerator is 1 minus alpha plus n alpha, and initial number of moles, that is 1. So van der Waals factor I is equal to 1 minus alpha plus n alpha divided by 1, and by simplifying we get the value for alpha, that is alpha is equal to I minus 1 divided by n minus 1. So I can also be calculated using the formula we have seen in the previous slides. So I is equal to theoretical molecular weight divided by observed molecular weight, or observed colligative property divided by theoretical colligative property. Thus, by knowing I value and number of ions produced, that is n value, we can simply calculate the value of alpha, that is degree of dissociation. So degree of association. So degree of association means the fraction of one mole which is associated into bigger size molecule, that is polymer. Here also the symbol is alpha. And for example, if n a reversible arrow 1 a n, that means n moles of a are associated to give 1 mole of the polymer an. So this now considering this reaction, let 1 mole of A is present initially, alpha be the fraction of this 1 mole which is associated. So at equilibrium, the number of moles of reactant, that is 1 minus alpha, that is the number of moles of A, and alpha by n, that is n moles of A gives 1 mole of A. So from alpha mole, alpha by n moles of product is formed. So alpha by n is the number of moles of product. So van der Waals factor, that is total number of moles at equilibrium divided by initial number of moles, that is given by 1 minus alpha, that is number of moles of reactant at equilibrium, and plus alpha by n, that is number of moles of polymer product at equilibrium. So 1 minus alpha plus alpha by n divided by 1. So on by simplifying, the value of alpha, that is given by I minus 1 n divided by 1 minus n. So I also can be calculated using the formula theoretical molecular weight divided by observed molecular weight, or from observed colligative property divided by theoretical colligative property. Thus, by knowing the value of I and number of moles of reactant associated, that is n, one can simply calculate the value of alpha, that is degree of association.
Now I want to conclude my lecture. This lecture covers major portion of syllabus regarding dilute solution and colligative properties for third BSc chemistry students. I think this lecture is more useful for UG students of Bharathidas University. I wish all the students all success. I express my sincere thanks to all viewers, and also I want to get positive and negative comments from viewers. That makes me the future lecture in a better way. Once again, I thank one and all. Thank you.